The 25th of every month has been designated as Orange Day as part of the UN Women's Say No, Unite campaign, which speaks to ending violence against women. Participants are encouraged to wear a touch of orange in solidarity with the cause. The color symbolizes a brighter future and a world free from violence. Welcome to Jamaica Magazine. I'm Adrian Atkinson. Stay tuned. Throughout the month of November, we have been tackling numerous finance-related topics, and this week is no different. Today, we take a look at the Revenue Appeals Division.
Welcome to Finance Matters, a production of the Ministry of Finance and the Public Service. I'm your host, Daniel Pasley, and today we'll be focusing on the appeals process of the Revenue Appeals Division and the successes of the RAD. And today we'll be speaking to Commissioner of the Revenue Appeals Division, Dr. Delary Staple Chambers. And she'll be talking about what happens after the decision has been made after appeals case, as well as some successes. Thank you so much for coming on the program once again, Commissioner.
Well, it's good to be here, Daniel.
So, the decision has been made. What happens next?
Right. So the law mandates that the Commission of Revenue Appeals has to issue the decision in writing, explaining and explain how that decision was made. So we produce a document which outlines the facts that were presented by both sides. So it summarizes the facts, and then it includes our findings and analysis of that findings, and the determination in terms of what the final liability of the taxpayer is. Now, the law prescribes that we can either confirm the decision that was made by the Commissioner of the Revenue Authority, or we can reduce that decision. We can set that decision aside and make a new decision, as well as we can vary the decision. What we cannot do, however, is increase the amount. So even if we determine through the facts that were presented that the assessment should have been more, we cannot increase it because we're not an assessing, we're not a tax assessing authority. Now, once we have made that decision and we produce that written document, it is dispatched to the parties, and on the receipt of that decision, the taxpayer has a further right to appeal.
Right.
However, the decision is binding on the commissioner of TAJ or JCA. So right now they do not have the right to appeal the Revenue Appeals Division decision, but the taxpayer can.
Let us look at some of the successes. I had a conversation with you some hours ago, and you were talking to me about modernization, mm-hmm. how that is so crucial to the RAD. Could you tell us, or should I say tell our viewers a little bit more about that?
Right. So the Revenue Appeals Division Act of 2015 modernized the tax appeals laws in Jamaica. So since we have implemented this legislation in June 2015, we have managed to reduce the turnaround time of cases by at least one third. So we were like 36 months to 40 months turnaround time. We are now 24 at the end of last fiscal year, 24 months turnaround.
Right.
And this year we are on track to be within 18 months turnaround time. Our goal our goal by 2021 is to be within a 6-month turnaround, which is basically in line with international best practice. So we are
Great.
Well on track where that is concerned.
So once that is achieved, then you'll be able to eliminate some of the backlog. Well, you have been eliminating some of the backlog of
right.
those cases.
So we have introduced a backlog elimination project last year. That comes to an end May 2019. And what we did was to target the closure of cases that were older than 24 months at the end of March 2016. and we are pretty close to completing those. We have gone through more than 50% of that workload already, and that has contributed to the reduction in the times that we're now seeing. With the cases that come in now, current cases are now being kept current, so we're not adding to our backlog. So once a case enters the Revenue Appeals Division now, it can be assigned to someone almost immediately. Prior to that, it had a wait time of maybe 24 months sometimes. So that is a marked improvement, and that engenders the reduction, the continued reduction of the turnaround time, and also put us in good stead of providing better service to our taxpaying public.
Well, we've run out of time. Thank you so much for coming on the program, Commissioner. It was a pleasure.
Certainly was mine as well, Daniel. Thank you for having us.
So thank you so much to you, our viewers, for watching Finance Matters. I'm Daniel Pasley, and we will see you next time.
I'm sure my neighbors hear the screams and cries.
I'm sure by now they've seen the bruises through my oversized glasses.
Can they tell I'm depressed when we speak?
Are they counting my frequent days off from work?
Domestic violence is any pattern of behavior used by an individual to maintain control or power over another. Domestic violence is not just physical, it can also be verbal. If you're in a relationship where you are being abused or know of anyone, get out and speak up. Report domestic violence by calling 119 or the nearest police station. Get out before someone puts you out.
Here's one group that's ensuring females not only have a mentor, but a friend in time of need.
What we try to do is to organize women who can support each other, who can offer not just information, but sometimes it's tangible support that they need. Sometimes they need opportunities, they need connections. And what we try to do is to link local women with those globally. This mentoring walk is taking place in more than 50 countries around the world, and we're a part of a global network, and it's helpful to tap into and leverage those global resources, those global folks, and the knowledge base that they have and the support systems that are available that women right here are able to access.
I make it a duty to be here this morning to just indulge in the fun and this experience and to learn something new. I'm sure I can take home something from today's activity. So I want to get the motivation, because as females in the whole work industry and stuff, you don't get that much support that you should. So a group of females coming together to motivate each other and, you know, inspire each other. Yes, I'm going to take that home.
Came here just to share with women out of my experience, you know, the values that I have inherited through the programs that I've been a part of.
I have two young ladies with me, lovely ladies who actually need no mentoring, Camille and Alafia, and they are students at the Caribbean Maritime Institute. But we've just been talking generally about their academics, their career goals, and I'm trying to share some tips with them about what it's like out there in the real working world, but they're already really on the right track.
So in this walk, I was able to get mentor and help connections, because I would like to become a pilot in the future, and it's not everyone knows the direction or path that is supposed to be taken. So I benefit a lot from this walk, and I hope to gain more.
Oh, Oh, we can do it in so many ways, just in terms of supporting each other's businesses, understanding and knowing what we do, seeing where some of the shortfalls are in terms of, it's a man's world, that's the truth. So how can we open doors for each other? How can we consume more from each other? How can we build each other up where we have weaknesses or gaps? So do we have weaknesses in terms of management styles or certain particular skills that another woman can help with? I think it's really a question of networking and connecting and just opening those doors, opening those opportunities for women.
We need to make a decision to be active, not be passive, not just be observers of what we're facing, but come together and say, okay, we know that in numbers, there's the ability to make an impact, especially when we live in an age where our voice is so powerful. Social media is a platform that gives us such a strong voice that causes people to have to listen to that voice. So how can we start with a simple thing as our voice? We may not think we have the resources to make a difference. We may not think we have the position to make a difference. We may not think we have the network to make a difference. But how could we come together and with something just as simple as our voice?
As women, we need to support each other, come together, make the connection, and try to achieve, help the young people to achieve their goals. Because I think the young people today are a little wayward, because I've been working in the schools and I've seen their behavior, their actions, and I think they really need a mentoring.
If we know that something is going on in their life or in their environment, we can offer a helping hand, because I think that a lot of women today, they see things and they turn a blind eye to it. Then when the situation increases, we sit back and we wonder, what have they been doing? Why can't anybody help them when you are there to offer assistance? And I think that once we start knowing how to care and share our responsibilities with each other, then Jamaica can be a better place.
We can also use the same social media as a positive mode to share what is actually happening in Jamaica. So the time that persons will spend to share and post a video of something negative, we can use that as a positive mode.
Be open about embracing the help from other women, because I find that women always find it challenging to accept that another woman is helping and not trying to destroy. So it's just about being open to the friendship from another woman and trust that it's for a better good.
Want all of you to start thinking about how are you going to level up this November. And level up for us starts with self. So it's really a call to action for you to look at yourself and to see what can you do better, what more can you give, what more do you want to be. So we want all of you to use Youth Month to recommit to do more, to do better, to go harder. But not just for self, but for communities, because we believe that young people can change communities. But more than that, level up in your own lives so that we can level up Jamaica. Level up! Level up! Level up.
They are deemed nurturers of the household, caregivers, friends. Mothers have a huge role to play in the lives of their children. Yes, we're still zoning in on our women. It's interesting how they make even the hardest of tasks look easy. Watch as this mother takes special care of her child with special needs.
Meet Alex Fraser. He's a 10-year-old student of Dunrobin Primary School in Kingston. He's just like most of the boys his age. He loves to play football, hang out with his friends, and play computer games. The only major difference, he cannot walk like most other boys his age. Alex was born with spina bifida, a condition where a baby's neural tube fails to develop normally, causing damage to the spinal cord and bones of the spine. Alex's mother, Tamara Brown, has three other children, all of whom have no birth defects. But from Alex's birth, Tamara was determined that he would be given the same opportunities.
I want Alec to have a good education. No matter if anything happened to me tomorrow, I want him to have a good education. Can't complain. The children, them, the teachers, love him a lot.
It's fun having Alex around, even though sometimes it's like he's not even there. He's so quiet, he's so obedient, and he gets along well with his peers.
Parenting a child with disabilities like Alex's takes extra special loving care.
I have to make sure, go to school, eat, because Alex is a very sick child. Alex has high blood pressure. He has a kidney problem. They have to take antibiotics every day. They have to take mineral oil every day.
It means Tamara has to be at school with Alex for the entire school day on many occasions, as there are times when he doesn't have an assigned special needs assistant.
We are always here for Alex's mom and for Alex. She has been a strong parent though, doesn't complain a lot. But we have been there in support, maybe for lunch or any advice that she needs. So she has been a great parent. Alex's mother, she never gives up. She really wants the best for her child, and she should be commended for actually fighting to get the best in life for Alex. And we're happy he's a part of us.
I would like to have a computer when I grow up.
Antonika Gunter-Gale, director of the Early Stimulation Program in the Ministry of Labor and Social Security, works closely with parents of children like Alex, especially in the early stages.
Parents, guardians, caregivers of children with disabilities face a number of issues. Financial, you know, is one of them. When you take, for instance, sometimes a child with special needs go beyond the years of using diapers, you know. They have to take soft food. So that means, you know, the blending, the buying of certain food items, you know. So there are a number of challenges. Medication, you think about appointments. The child needs to go to the hearing, you know, specialist. The child needs to go to the audiology. The child needs to go to various appointments, and it does take cash, you know, to care on the part of the parent for persons who don't understand that this is a child with special needs, and the child, you know, act up in the public, screaming, shouting, hyperactive, a child with autism, you know, very antisocial, not getting on like his peers. These things can really cause much stress to the parents of children with disabilities.
But you might ask, how can a regular parent afford all these expenses? And are there any existing support programs for parents of children with disabilities?
There are a number of support through the Ministry of Labor and Social Security under which this program falls, the Early Stimulation Program. A mother, guardian, who really cannot find the wherewithal to care. You have support in terms of intervention. You have financial assistance in terms of a rehabilitation grant that is offered through the ministry for parents or guardians of children with special needs. You have the Jamaica Council for persons with disabilities that also offer support and financial assistance for, you know, starting up your own business, advice, and, you know, that sort of a thing. So there are a number of areas. We have the PATH program that assists with adaptive aids, you know, such as hearing aids, walkers, wheelchairs, medication.
For parents who, like Tamara Brown, are unable to maintain regular jobs as a result of having to be with their disabled children at home or school, The early stimulation program guides them to numerous entrepreneurship opportunities.
We have parents, for example, a simple thing as making soaps, different soaps, putting together, you know, soaps that is tested and passed, approved through the Bureau of Standards, you know, selling soaps. We have mothers doing phone cards. We have parents doing their little craft at home, rearing chickens at home, doing eggs, you know. So there are a number of areas while taking care of the child at home the parent could do.
For more information, you may contact the Early Stimulation Program at 95 Hanover Street, Kingston. Call them at 922-5585. Children with special needs need extra special parents.
Our children are different. All of them require patience, love, understanding. So we want to remind all adults that every child is our child, and we must see how we can give them that love, that patience, that understanding, so that they can become their best selves.
Christmas time, feel the breeze? Yes, it's Christmas time. Jamaica is definitely the place to be this upcoming holiday season. Warm sun, beautiful beaches, and amazing people. Those are just the basics. Here are some other reasons you should join me right here in Jamaica.
Living in Jamaica is an experience that you cannot put in words. There's an energy in the atmosphere that just feels good. There are so many aspects of Jamaica that I think makes it second to none. The best food, the best music, the best people. We can go on and on about the good things about living in Jamaica.
The prolific artist is one of nine faces selected by the Jamaica Tourist Board to beckon visitors to join them in the home of all right. The Jamaica Tourist Board is banking on the reach and popularity of social media to go where they have never gone before. To connect with potential visitors, hopefully to convince them to book a trip to the island based on the stories of these personalities who will pop up on their timeline. The hashtag #JoinMeInJamaica digital marketing videos, each about 90 seconds, are disseminated via the Tourist Board's social media platforms.
Come out and meet us, come out and experience what Jamaica has to offer.
The Songbird and Dancehall Prince join the likes of the coffee expert, the sister cooks, the hotel chef, the pudding man, the Rasta artist, and the entrepreneur.
And as we started kind of working on this and coming up with some ideas, and Join Me in Jamaica evolved, we settled on that because it's this great call to action. But it's deeper than that. It enables the people we talk with to say, why join me in Jamaica?
Name them all. Being a man, they all come here and buy their pudding. This is what we grew up on. Now, when the people come to Jamaica, everybody, as soon as they land off the plane, this is where they come. They want to taste this pudding because it's bringing them back to the old days.
You talk about scripting things or putting things together, and you hope for words and magic. And then you try to get somebody to deliver that line. It's just not real. But when we hiked to the top of Blue Mountain in the rain, to the top, we sit there and talk to him, and his face lit up, and his smile was just so infectious, and all of a sudden he comes out with, God has been good to us, the universe has been good to us, this rock, I love it.
I love it. These videos will now populate our social space, and we'll be able to have connectivity to every corner of the world. And the language part of it, yes, we've worked on. And the technology allows instant translation.
It doesn't mean that we will not do traditional advertising anymore. Because if that is in anybody's mind, then we need to disabuse ourselves of that. In anybody's mind, then we need new space. We can reach more people in places that we could never even think of reaching them before. One, because of costs. Two, because of logistics. Three, because it's just not profitable to do. A content-rich communication to the world about what makes Jamaica special. And who best to tell that story but some very hardcore, well-enabled, well-entrenched Jamaicans who have served Jamaica in many ways, different ways, in a very authentic way, tell their own story about why anybody should join them in Jamaica.
Every Jamaican has this passionate, loving story, and we want to capture that and share it with the world, because I believe the rest of the world could learn a little bit from Jamaica. One love.
So here are the facts.
7 out of 10 Jamaicans die from a non-communicable disease.
Because we love our people and we want them to live better quality lives,
we, the Ministry of Health and our partners, are launching Jamaica Moves.
Jamaica Moves is a call to action to prevent non-communicable diseases.
By educating and encouraging Jamaicans to be active, eat healthy,
and start living 30 minutes at a time.
Because 30 minutes of physical activity each day, along with proper nutrition, can go a long way
to prevent your risk from developing certain NCDs, such as diabetes, high blood pressure, obesity, and certain cancers.
And remember, it's life promoting. That's why you see me going hard right now.
I'm all about living.
So help us take this first step towards a healthier Jamaica, so you can enjoy more moments, more memories, more life. As mentioned earlier, today is being observed as International Day for the Elimination of Violence Against Women. Here are some facts.
1 in 3 women and girls experience physical or sexual violence in their lifetime, most frequently by an intimate partner.
Worldwide, almost 750 million women and girls alive today were married before their 18th birthday, while 200 million women and girls have undergone female genital mutilation.
71% of all human trafficking victims worldwide are women and girls. 3 out of 4 of these women and girls are sexually exploited.
Violence against women is as serious a cause of death and incapacity among women of reproductive age as cancer, and a greater cause of ill health than traffic accidents and malaria combined. Join the Jamaican government as they work to protect all females against all forms of abuse and ensuring that they have a future to make changes in our society. End violence against women. Start right here, at home, creating the change needed to make Jamaica the place of choice to live, work, raise families, and do business. Thanks for watching another edition of Jamaica Magazine. Do join us again tomorrow and we'll do this all over again. Please send your feedback on today's show to jamaicamagazine@jis.gov.jm. Also, follow us on our social media pages, Instagram, Facebook, and of course, Twitter. Download our app on your Apple and Android devices, and you can also visit our website, jis.gov.jm, for more information. On behalf of the entire production crew, I'm Adrian Atkinson. Thanks for watching.
This has been a production of the Jamaica Information Service, the voice of Jamaica.